true that humans are the only animals that do not manufacture vitamin C?
Yes, it's true. Most other animals do. They manufacture their own from sugar. We do not.
And so where do we get vitamin C in the diet?
Well, the only place where we can get it from would be from, fruits and vegetables, but mostly citrus fruits. Some vegetables like onions and garlic, but pretty much most fruits and vegetables will contain some amounts of vitamin C.
Now, is there enough vitamin C in the fruits and vegetables to ward off colds, flus?
Well, for the most part, there isn't, and there are several reasons for this. One has to do with the quality of the foods. We do not have the same quality of foods as we used to have 100 years ago. The addition of pesticides and other chemicals has detracted from the nutritive value of most fruits and vegetables. And the other thing is that we're under large amounts of stress now, which we may not have been under, many years ago. And as a result of that, we need much more than fruits and vegetables can provide for us.
So what is the relationship between stress and vitamin C?
Well, the more stress we're under, the more vitamin C that we're going to need, because the body uses it up in its combat against stress. And it uses it for its protection for the immune system. And it uses it as something that's is going to fight off infections, viruses, cancer, and a lot of other diseases.
Is there a similar connection between vitamin C and adrenal glands, supporting your adrenal glands, as there is between B-complex and adrenals? Or?
Yes, I think vitamin C is one of the most important nutrients for the adrenal glands, along with B-complex, zinc, magnesium, and protein.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people feel that the winter months, we're going to stock up on vitamin C, we're going to take 500 milligrams a day. What about the rest of the year? What about summer when there's allergies?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I think we need vitamin C all year round, partially for allergies, but also for stress and for boosting our immunity. And I think if your diet is not adequate in vegetables and fruits, then you're probably going to need a lot more vitamin C from supplemental form.
And vitamin C is water soluble, correct?
That's correct.
So
yes.
How does a person know when they've had enough vitamin C?
Well, the simple answer to that is how well their bowels are moving. One of the things that I try to educate my patients on is something called vitamin C to bowel tolerance, which means you take just enough vitamin C that will almost produce loose bowel movements, and then you back off a little bit. That's your bowel tolerance dose. And somewhere between 0 milligrams and, 20,000 milligrams, you're going to find your right amount of vitamin C.
What about the rumor, if it's a rumor, that too much vitamin C can cause kidney stones? I hear that all the time.
Yeah, that's an old myth. That's never been proven by any studies. In fact, I can list you about 12 studies that show that vitamin C actually prevents kidney stones. So that's something that's, science fiction.
Don't have to worry about it.
No, not at all.
Now, vitamin C is an antioxidant. Can you explain exactly what an antioxidant is and does?
Well, basically, an antioxidant is something that protects your cells from damage by environmental toxins. Mm-hmm. So those are called oxidative agents. So that could be things like tobacco smoke, alcohol, chemicals that are found on our food supply, like pesticides, and also prescription drugs and any kind of street drugs, for example. All of those damage our cells, and as a result of that, we end up with various diseases. What vitamin C does is it protects the lining of the cells, and it protects your organs from damage by the environment, basically.
Mm-hmm. How what's the connection between vitamin C and healthy blood vessels?
Well, vitamin C is one of the most important nutrients to maintain the integrity of your blood vessels, the endothelial wall, it's called. And Linus Pauling years ago was able to prove that if you take enough vitamin C, then you can prevent damage that leads to what's called intimal thickening, and which leads then into hardening of the arteries and blockages in the arteries. So vitamin C is one of the most crucial of all the nutrients that allows, or prevents coronary artery disease, for example.
Now, he had talked about vitamin C 10,000 milligrams a day, correct?
Right.
Is that for preventing these things or to treat these things? Or
I think he was talking more about prevention. Now, in cases where you actually have established artery disease, then I think the dosages have to be much higher, and you have to do a lot of other things as well to improve circulation.
And then vitamin C is very important for connective tissue, is that not right?
That's right. So it's important for all your joints, muscles, ligaments, bones, and so on.
I have to say, my mother mixes her Nivea cream with vitamin C, crushes it up, and puts it on her skin, and she has great skin.
Right.
So have you heard of this, that vitamin
Yes.
C?
Absolutely, vitamin C. Well, because of its antioxidant properties, it's able to protect the skin from aging, from damage. So,
and how does vitamin C work in terms of being a natural antihistamine?
Well, that's interesting you should mention that, because a lot of people use vitamin C as a treatment for allergic symptoms. And if you put the dosage of vitamin C high enough, you get an antihistaminic effect like you would with any antihistamine. And it stops mostly just about all allergy symptoms, the runny nose, the postnasal drip, the swollen eyes, etc.
So these are airborne allergies or food allergies or chemical sensitivities, all of it?
They could be all of it, yes.
Mm-hmm. And there's two parts, I guess, to vitamin C. There's vitamin C and then there's the bioflavonoids. How do they work hand in hand? How does it...
Well, in nature, vitamin C exists with bioflavonoids, and these are things like rutin, hesperidine, catechin, bilberry has also some bioflavonoids. So there's many different forms of those, and they basically work like antihistamines as well, and they also protect the cells from damage, just like vitamin C does.
I was reading your article, and you mentioned gout. Very painful condition. Basically, the only resolution is medication, changing diet. But you're saying vitamin
right.
C resolves gout?
Yes, because vitamin C pushes uric acid, which is the cause of gout, out of the system. So if you take enough vitamin C, then you can basically reduce the symptoms of gout.
Do people ever get stomach irritation from taking vitamin C?
Some people do, and these people are probably best to use a buffered form of vitamin C. But that's pretty rare because vitamin C is a very weak acid. If you compare it to something like cola beverages or other soft drinks, then...
The real acid,
that's like less like way more than vitamin C. So most people can tolerate it quite well.
Okay, and bilberry, that's one of the bioflavonoids.
Yes.
That's very important in eye health?
Yes, it is. It's been found that the antioxidants found, with bioflavonoids... protect the eye from damage. And also vitamin C is very important. For example, in glaucoma, it's been found that you can prevent or you can lower the eye pressures by taking enough vitamin C. Because if you bathe the eye in vitamin C, the pressures are reduced, the circulation in the eye itself is improved.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
So vitamin C is a kind of a cure-all.
Yeah, it has a lot of real beneficial properties.
I want to read a 700% increase in the past 2.5 decades of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma in men. What exactly is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma?
Well, it's starting to become the most common form of lymphoma. It used to be that there was one type of lymphoma, Hodgkin's lymphoma, but the cellular structure in non-Hodgkin's, there's several different varieties. I won't bore you with the details there, but basically, it responds very nicely to intravenous vitamin C. And the reason for that might be because what vitamin C does is it causes the cells to make more hydrogen peroxide. And peroxide is toxic to cancer cells, but is very safe and is non-damaging to your own cells.
So do you use vitamin C IV therapy solely without chemotherapy, without traditional therapies?
In some cases I do, because I have quite a few patients in my practice who refuse chemotherapy, and for them we use intravenous vitamin C for non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and we are getting some spectacularly good results with it.
In fact, we have another video that that we did with some of your patients that have
Yes.
had remarkable recoveries.
Yes, I think I've had about six patients that had the intravenous vitamin C but refused chemotherapy, and they're still quite well.
And if this is the case, why doesn't traditional medicine take a look at this? I mean, it's such a harmless therapy.
Well, the main reason why is because I think it was about 10, 15 years ago, somebody did a study which showed that oral vitamin C has no impact on cancer, and that they proved that vitamin C has no benefit for reversing cancer. But they have recently done some studies using intravenous vitamin C, and the story is quite different. So the intravenous form gets the concentrations of vitamin C high enough in the bloodstream to actually produce an effect on cancer, whereas the oral form does not.
So what doses are you talking about when you talk about IV therapy?
Well, we're talking about doses here of 50 to 75,000 milligrams, which if you took it orally would produce diarrhea before you got anywhere near that level. So You cannot do that unless you give it intravenously.
And along with that, do you work with diet? Do you work with other supplements?
Yes, it's a whole program. It's a program of a alkaline-forming diet, as well as, you know, a broad spectrum of different antioxidants, things like greens. You know, we use also selenium. We use some medications in some cases, like naltrexone. We may use other antioxidants as well.
And what's the advantage of TriStar has come out with this fabulous liquid that tastes, I had tasted it before, blueberry flavor. What's the advantage of liquid?
Well, the advantage there is that it can be used quite easily by children and by the elderly. Mm-hmm. People who don't like to take capsules or tablets, they usually respond a lot better to the liquid form. Cheers.
It looks like mouthwash, but here goes. This is really good.
Yeah, absolutely.
I want the whole bottle.
You can have it.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.